As the United Nations RioPlus20 Conference on Sustainable Development gets underway this month in Rio de Janeiro, a vivid example of the environmental and social tensions that accompany economic development will be playing out 1,500 miles to the north. There, on the Xingu River in Brazil's Amazon Basin, a consortium of companies is building the Belo Monte Dam complex. It will be the world's third largest hydroelectric project and promises to produce enormous amounts of electricity for Brazil's booming economy. But Belo Monte's three dams will also flood 260 square miles of rainforest and other lands, displace more than 20,000 people, and have significant environmental and social impacts. The election last year of Brazilian President Dilma Rousseff put the dam on the fast track, and it's expected to begin generating electricity just 3 years from now. Yet critics contend that by turning large stretches of the Xingu River into reservoirs, the dam complex will threaten not only many endemic fish species, but also the indigenous tribes, like the Arara and the Juruna, whose livelihoods depend upon free-flowing rivers. Nowhere is the tension greater than in Altamira, the Amazonian city where Belo Monte is being built. And while some people there are excited by opportunities for work on the dam, others who have lived in the region for decades believe nothing good will come from it.
Essa vida toda que se encontra aqui nesse momento irá mudar drasticamente. Tudo isso vai se transformar numa seca permanente.
Sheila Juruna is an indigenous leader who has spent most of her adult life opposing the dam project. She says if the dam is built, thousands of indigenous Indians and river people along the Xingu will not be able to use the water or travel back and forth to Altamira to get food and medical supplies. She also fears the flooding of indigenous lands.
Então aqui, exatamente nesse local, está prevista a construção do grande paredão da hidrelétrica de Belo Monte, um paredão que tem como de comprimento 6 quilômetros de distância, que atravessa essa parte dessa ilha para o outro lado, a Ilha do Pimentel. Imaginar isso é muito triste, porque barrar o rio é como se barrasse parte do nosso corpo.
Não.
But executives involved in the Belo Monte project dispute her assertions, saying they have altered their plans to avoid flooding key indigenous lands.
Então o impacto realmente é muito pequeno.
They also contend that the dam project will not dry out rivers in the Xingu Basin, as Juruna fears.
Não vai haver seca. Ela, a vazão do rio vai ser mantida tal como ela é no período de seca. Então, portanto, não há o menor perigo de que haja uma seca na Volta Grande. Não vai haver impacto nas terras indígenas. Nenhuma área indígena vai ser inundada.
João Pimentel is an executive at Norte Energia, the consortium in charge of the dam. He says the company will create a tugboat system to keep boats moving back and forth to Altamira on slack sections of the Xingu, as demonstrated in this company video.
To navigate this stretch, riverboats simply tie up to the tugboat to be towed either up or downstream.
Pimentel also stresses that Belo Monte will produce clean energy that is essential to Brazil's burgeoning economy.
O crescimento projetado é para 2020. Nós temos que colocar alguma coisa em torno de 5 mil megawatts de energia proveniente de novos empreendimentos. Essa necessidade faz com que o Brasil tenha que explorar os recursos que são aqueles mais limpos.
He says over the next decade, Brazil will need to increase its installed electric generation capacity by 60%.
Portanto, Belo Monte foi um dos projetos escolhidos para atender a essa necessidade que o governo brasileiro tem de pôr essa energia à disposição da população.
Pimentel says 70% of the power generated by Belo Monte will be sent to Brazil's national grid, and once transmission lines are ready, the generated power will be available in all parts of the country.
The first thing is to define what are needs, because needs implies it's something that you have to have, and a lot of this energy that is being called needs is not.
Professor Philip Fernside works at INPA, the National Institute for Research in the Amazon. He has been studying hydroelectric dams for more than 30 years.
Adding more and more energy to the grid has a benefit in terms of having more reliable power. But a lot of what is being done with the energy in Belo Monte is not the supplying of cities and domestic use of the energy. It's being used for these so-called electro-intensive products like aluminum. And that is something that has simply not been discussed in Brazil.
Fernside also disagrees with those who categorize hydroelectric dams as clean energy. He says the methane they release is an important contributor to global warming, and that officials are underestimating such releases from hydroelectric dams, especially in the tropics.
It has been repeated many, many times that hydroelectric dams produce clean energy. So many people believe this without knowing anything about the subject. But actually, they produce greenhouse gas emissions, both carbon dioxide and methane, which is more potent than carbon dioxide.
Fernside explains that hydroelectric dams become methane factories because after land is cleared, methane forms when trees and vegetation decompose at the bottom of reservoirs. He says methane is then released into the atmosphere through water bubbles and a dam's turbines. What's more, he's highly critical of the emissions counting process in Brazil.
In the case of the Belo Monte hydroelectric dam, the environmental impact statement has a section on greenhouse gas emissions, but it leaves out most of the emissions.
But other experts say that greenhouse gas emissions from reservoirs behind dams like Belo Monte are far lower than if the electricity was produced by burning fossil fuels. And Pimentel says Fernside and others are looking at data from earlier plans for Belo Monte.
A oposição a Belo Monte basicamente por falta de informação técnica. Eu, inclusive na questão do metano, as pessoas se baseiam muito em outros empreendimentos que foram feitos e que, na época, a legislação ambiental não era rigorosa como é atualmente. No caso específico da emissão de metano, toda a madeira, que é o grande responsável pela emissão de metano, vai ser retirada do leito do rio antes de se fazer o lago, o reservatório de Belo Monte. Portanto, não há o risco da emissão de metano nos níveis que as pessoas calcularam.
Marcio Zimmermann, former Deputy Minister of Mines and Energy,
tá, okay.
Agrees.
Na verdade, hoje eu posso citar até um estudo do Banco Mundial onde mostrava que o Brasil tem uma das legislações ambientais mais rigorosas do mundo.
But this legislation is precisely what Fernside and others take issue with.
So you have an environmental impact study that's 36 volumes, around 20,000 pages, and it's basically a work of fiction if it doesn't include what is really going to happen with other dams upstream. Well, Belo Monte is significant because it itself has a major impact, but also it's sort of a spear point for dismantling the whole system of environmental licensing and regulation here.
Zimmermann emphasizes that hydroelectric dams have and will continue to play a key role in Brazil's energy mix and in fostering economic development and creating much-needed jobs.
Nós achamos que é importante que os países em desenvolvimento consigam atingir e satisfazer a sua sociedade, mas não só com relação à energia elétrica, mas também com a geração de emprego, com a geração de melhoria das condições de vida dessa população.
That's deceptive reasoning, says Renata Pinheiro.
Belo Monte today is being used by government, federal and state government, and even municipalities as a source of progress, development, and actually public politics.
Until recently, Pinheiro worked in Altamira with the activist group Xingu Alive Forever.
I think things are going really bad because this federal government is changing all the environmental laws, the rules of Environmental licensing for in Brazil for huge projects. It's a process that has no participation of society. If government builds all these 77 huge dams, it's going to be the destruction of the Amazon. It's going to be over. There won't be Amazon forest anymore. There won't be traditional communities anymore. We're going to be, this Amazon will become a huge industrial region of Brazil.
Reflecting on the recent social changes in Altamira, brought on by dam construction, including overcrowding, a spike in crime, and skyrocketing inflation, Pinheiro favors alternatives to hydroelectric dams, such as wind and solar.
We need a complex solution. We need to touch every side of this problem. We need to change the production matrix of energy in Brazil. We need to diversify it, investing in wind and solar energy.
Still, Pimentel and Zimmerman say Brazil continues to invest in and create wind and solar facilities. But, they explain, because government studies find hydroelectric dams to have the least impact on the environment while providing the most dependable energy, they remain the country's flagship source of renewable energy. Besides, argues Pimentel, people don't understand the impacts of wind and solar. But for Fernside and other critics of Belo Monte, the biggest concern is that the project is among the first of scores of hydroelectric projects in the Amazon basin that will usher in an era of unprecedented development in the world's largest and most biodiverse tropical forest region.
The plans involve damming virtually all of the rivers that are tributaries to the Amazon, so it's something that has tremendous impacts all over the Amazon, and it's very important that those impacts be properly analyzed and the decisions be made weighing the full impacts and the benefits instead of exaggerating the benefits and minimizing the impacts.
Brazil's needs for energy are real.
Por isso nós não aceitamos impedimento de barragem no nosso rio.
But so are the concerns of environmentalists and indigenous groups. And it remains an open question whether the Belo Monte Dam complex can be built without causing irreparable harm to the environment and to indigenous cultures in the heart of the Amazon.